ago, war reached into the American home, and the farewells were everywhere. The farms, the shanty on the tracks, the lavish apartments, the uptown flats, the shrubbed estates, the modest houses of the suburban streets. Everywhere the men were borrowed or taken for keeps. The youngest, the cleanest, the best. Each man went into battle in his own way to do his own job. More than half of them saw combat service. A small percentage of these, not nearly as many as you may imagine, were in the front lines, in bullet and shell range of the enemy. For anyone of this latter group, a very special experience, he was at any moment expendable. For him, the baseball parks were full of late, exciting rallies. For him, the beach parties were not as pleasant as they had been a few summers before. For him, the rivers ran high, and the boating was not so good. For him, the flight decks were not as wide as the fields of Texas. For the rest, there were 1,000-odd military jobs, each dependent on the other, each vital to the winning of the war, each made memorable by the fact that it represented the protection of the lives and security of all of us. But whether in combat or not, whether a machine gunner 300 yards from the enemy or a switchboard operator 300 miles from the enemy, the serviceman learned about war. He knew the unutterable loneliness of it. He knew the unending boredom of it. He knew the mud of it, the dust of it. He knew the food of it. He knew the coffee of it. Whether in the heat of the equator or the cold of the Arctic, through it all he worked and waited and suffered and endured. Until one day he heard the bells of peace, turned his back on the darkened battlefields, and raised his arms to the bright new future. He returns with all his experiences in the fight to kill fascism, to kill Japism. Now he returns. With him, those who gave a permanent share of their bodies and minds to the nation. The permanently wounded physically, 1% of all returning servicemen. Those with severe emotional disorders, 1% of all returning servicemen. But returning with them, the huge majority group, more than 9 out of 10, the unhurt physically or mentally, the average returning soldier. It is of him we speak, of this average soldier, that we report on the questions, has he changed? What has he learned? What does he want? Has he been brutalized by war? Can he readjust to the life and times of a civilian? Readjust? Consider some of his adjustments of the last few years. He adjusted to a considerable loss of privacy. He adjusted to the often unbearable authority of the top sergeant. He adjusted to $50 a month. He adjusted to the foxhole, the slit trench, and a number of unprecedented ways of going to bed. He adjusted to plenty. And through it all, he kept his stride. He didn't lose his sense of humor. He brought the touch of the Connecticut Yankee to the banks of the Rhine. He ran a country fair in India. He staged the Kentucky Derby in Austria. He relaxed in the luxurious resorts of Europe and went nightclubbing in the islands of the Pacific. In England, he learned about rugby. And somewhere in the Mediterranean, he discovered an old Egyptian game called three-card monte. He kept his stride. He didn't lose his sense of decency. There were times when he went hungry so that the kids would not. He was an ambassador to the children of the world. Let those who worry about his painful readjustment to civilian life remember his adjustment to war. Now he returns, the average soldier. Has he been brutalized by war? Listen to a very angry army chaplain.
Brutalized? That means, is this war going to breed a generation of hoodlums and gangsters who hold life cheaply? I've seen killing, but I've never met an American soldier who liked it. I've seen men under combat achieve a feeling of humanity such as I'm sure they'd never known before. Seen them comfort each other when homesickness shattered their spirit. Laugh together over common discomforts. Cry unashamedly when their comrades died. And without hesitation offer the final sacrifice. The risk of their lives to save another man's life. I saw democracy overseas as it's only talked about at home. There were no foxhole penthouses for the wealthy. No restricted areas for white Christians only. Brutality is something more than a surface matter revealed by rough beards, bloodshot eyes, strong language, torn clothes, muddy bodies. Real brutality is lack of imagination, a disregard for the rights of others, the very things we've been fighting to destroy. If there's any suspicion that returning soldiers are not fit for our civilization, I can only say it's an indictment of our civilization. Not of the soldiers.